And joining us now, as promised, as advertised, is Ron Paul, former 12-term congressman from the great state of Texas and former Republican presidential candidate, founder of the group Campaign for Liberty. And, of course, you watch him on his own TV show, and check that out at ronpaulchannel.com. Hello, fellow TV person.
Hello. Nice to be with you.
Nice to talk to you again. So how's that working out for you? How do you like doing the TV stuff?
Well, I have to work at it. I'm no natural, you know, into this TV, internet stuff, but no, it's going quite well. We're very happy with it.
You know, Piers Morgan is leaving. Maybe you should be knocking on CNN's door.
Well, you know, if you go to my Facebook, my numbers of people that visit me each day a lot more than he was having to visit his TV program.
No, I'm sure.
And I don't like to brag.
No, hey, brag. That's always a good thing to do. But when you're successful, just let people know it. All right, let's talk a little bit, first of all, about the breaking news just a short time ago. Chuck Hagel, the defense secretary, met with the press and announced that the military is going to undergo severe downsizing, especially the Army. The Army going back to pre-World War II levels, even though at the same time he says, you know, we face threats that are more dangerous than ever in many respects. I know, you know, well, I'll ask you, how do you feel about that?
Well, I think it's a good idea, but what I really want him to downsize on is the foreign policy, because if you stay involved in, 140 or 150 countries and have personnel around the world and stirring up trouble, but you downsize the military, you run into a problem. So I think it's our intervention that needs downsized, but I certainly agree that in this day and age, we shouldn't be building all these weapons. I wonder where he stands on the F-35. I mean, just think of that airplane. When are they going to have another dogfight? And they say, well, it's to be the most advanced aircraft in the world ever and beat everybody before anybody else gets it, and they're going to spend $400 billion on it. It's just a total fiasco. So that kind of stuff they certainly could cut back on, but my suspicion is that the politics of even the F-35 means that they're not going to cut back.
All right, but foreign policy aside, and we could certainly debate that, and I know, you know, how you feel about that, but let's look at, you know, readiness, military readiness, if we need ground troops, if you cut back the Army. I mean, we're talking about National Guard might have more duties, reservists certainly would have to be called up. If a war were to start, it would take a lot of time to mobilize those people, and you know, we could suffer losses. So, and they're framing this, a lot of people are framing this as, well, the government won't cut entitlements, so they got to cut somewhere, and so we're cutting our military readiness.
Well, I think some of the military stuff is an entitlement because of the military-industrial complex. They have a lot of influence, and they build weapons they don't need, and they do a lot of things. But I wouldn't mind having a little bit of delay. Maybe they'll stop and think about it. There was a strong effort to send troops in and start dropping bombs, and we are still very much involved in Syria. And yet the people were saying, hey, enough is enough. We don't need another war. Hold off. And public pressure was such that they backed off on Syria. So I think a little bit of time and a little thoughtfulness might be of an advantage. I just don't like the idea that we have to plan on, having millions of troops that we have to invade and be the policemen of the world. That's where the fallacy is. Now, if you want to remain the policemen of the world, yes, you can't cut back. You probably won't even want to cut back as much as Hagel's talking about. But I just think a proper foreign policy would mean that we would have a strong national defense, but it would be quite a bit different. A lot of people equate military spending and national defense, and I don't. I believe very strongly in national defense, but I believe in a lot less military spending, and that's the big difference. So you don't need hundreds of thousands of troops planning for the next war, because there's nobody's going to invade us. Nobody's going to attack us. People say, well, yeah, but what about our interests, our worldwide interests? What about the oil? Well, I just don't believe in mercantilism, where we have to have troops in the Middle East to protect our oil. And we call it our oil when it really isn't. Especially when you allow the market to work, you have what's going on in the United States today. We're producing more oil than Saudi Arabia. So that would be my answer to some of our foreign policy problems.
All right. Let me ask you about Ukraine. There was the president has warned Russia, so they say. I can't picture it really happening, but the president has warned Russia to stay out of what's going on in Ukraine, especially after the president there has fled and they're reconstructing their government and whatnot. What do you think the role of the United States should be with regard to Ukraine?
Well, I don't think it's our business. If I had my preference, all foreign influence would be removed. That would mean we would leave, Europeans would leave, and so Russia would leave. But, of course, that's not going to happen. I would say there's a lot more justified interest from Russia as well as the Europeans than it is United States. I mean, that's 7,000 miles away, so I doubt very much if we can justify it. But I look at it as if we had some type of problem like this in Mexico on our borders, and there was a threat to us, and Russia was very much involved. I would say that we are more justified morally and for strategic reasons to be involved than we are when we're on the Russian border. Now, if anybody would be interested in a suggestion, mine would be, to always go with the smallest unit of government. What about the old-fashioned idea of a confederation, loose-knit group of countries and colonies that we were supposed to be at one time, instead of one monolithic government? That's why I think, allowing the East go East and the West go West. I mean, they speak two different languages. They could still have a loose-knit country if they wanted, but I would like to see trade and travel open up in both directions, not either or.
Right.
The politicians get involved. And I think the Ukrainian people are actually very supportive of that. I've talked to people from Ukraine, and they're very much supportive, for having let the Ukrainians deal with their problems.
All right. Well, yeah, and usually, that kind of a utopian outcome usually doesn't take place without a civil war, unfortunately.
Right.
But now let me ask you about Ed Snowden. You launched a clemency petition for him. I don't understand, with all due respect, and I want to hear certainly what you have to say, I don't understand how anybody could view him as anything less than a traitor. If he had a problem, he could have gone to our Congress, he could have gone to our government, he could have gone to a newspaper here in this country. He didn't have to go to our enemies or our adversaries in great senses, Russia certainly, and give them everything that he got from our files.
Well, you have a little more confidence in our government than I do, because I know the people who run these.
But you're going to go to Russia?
Well, he had to, out of his own interest, to survive, because we would probably have assassinated him or killed him. He wouldn't have gotten a trial here. The intelligence committees are there to protect NSA. You say, well, that's good. That's for national defense. But NSA is the enemy of the people. They're the ones who are spying on the American people. They're the ones who lie to us constantly, and they're the ones who break our Constitution. So somebody like Snowden yields to a higher law, a moral law, and the Constitution. Yes, he is not supposed to give up secrets, but he never made a nickel on it. He never gave it to an enemy, and he gave the information to the American people. So call him a traitor is sort of like saying the American people must be the enemy, because he's telling us the truth that NSA is spying on the American people and on our allies. So I am one that the more truth you have, the better. And I don't. Government officials, when they lie to us, are never punished. But if somebody is a whistleblower, all of a sudden they're bad people.
But how do you know we didn't give any of our secrets to Russia? How do you know?
Well, first off, there's been no evidence. Nobody's been injured, and there's no evidence that he has. But the most important thing is that the information came to the American people. I don't think Daniel Ellsberg gave it to the enemy. He told the American people that the Vietnam War was all a hoax. It was based on lies, and we deserve to know the truth.
All right, let me ask you one or two more here, getting domestically involved here in Texas. We have this great controversy with Ted Nugent, calling the president a subhuman mongrel, which I think everybody could agree is totally inappropriate, and I would never do that, and you would never do that. However, do you see a bit of a double standard trying to tie Greg Abbott to him and make Greg Abbott suffer the consequences when, you know, Bill Maher gave $1 million to Obama and Bill Maher used the C word to describe, you know, Republican women, and he's a misogynist in the minds of many, and I could go right on down the line, you know, some in the media. Aaron Burnett, who has Ted Nugent on today, once called President Bush a monkey. I'm sure nobody knows that but me, but after today, maybe more people will know it. So do you see the double standard, and should Greg Abbott be tied or held responsible for what Ted Nugent said?
I think you're absolutely right. There is a double standard, and I don't think that you should be, you know, guilt by association. I think that's wrong. You know, that sort of came up one time in my presidential campaign that, you know, I had hundreds of thousands of donors, and somebody out there donated money that his views were not nice.
Right.
And they wanted me to say, oh, well, you must endorse it. No, well, why should they think that? I didn't, you know, endorse his viewpoints. You know, this sort of thing. So no, it's the media. I think it's guilt. They want to use guilt by association, and you're absolutely right. There is a double standard, and that should make us all unhappy, and that's why I think we should always seek the truth.
And on the issue of the president, you know, changing the law, you know, amending the law as he goes along, especially with the Affordable Care Act, but he's done it to other laws, selectively enforcing what he wants to. And every day now, every day, if I can't get it through Congress, I have a pen. How dangerous do you think this all is?
Well, it's very dangerous because he is breaking the law, he's breaking the Constitution, and we don't hold our government officials accountable. This is why I think when they lie to us, they should be held accountable. And I think if a citizen tells us the truth, because they are obeying their oath of office in the Constitution, they shouldn't be punished for it. But no, I think it's out of control, but it's been going on for a long time. I think this president has exceeded the others, but the others have participated. But what bothers me most about the current administration is not so much that they're doing things like the others have, but they're doing it more so. But this president is rather bold in saying, I'm going to do it.
Right.
I believe it's right, and there's nothing you're going to do about it. Before, you know, they knew it was wrong, and they sort of tried to keep it quiet. But now, it's almost like I'm in your face, and I can do what I want, and I'm going to change this law if I want. And if Congress doesn't act, I'm going to write a executive order. So I think it's that atmosphere that really worries me. That if we as a people put up with this, because in a sense, Obama's been pretty honest about this. You know, honest, I'm going to do it.
Yep.
And I think that's very dangerous.
Yep. Are you going to campaign for your son if he announces for president?
I will if it doesn't hurt him.
It's not going to hurt him. Do you think he will? You think he will run?
You know, I don't know, and I'm not sure whether he knows, but he's, you know, I'm sure he's feeling his way on it. But, you know, it's been so early. You know, this campaign started, I think, the day after the last campaign.
Right.
And they said, what do you think about Rand running? You know, it was right after the November election. I said, well, I'm still trying to count my votes I got, so I'm not ready.
I know
it started awfully early.
I know he told his wife when he ran for Senate, don't worry, there's no chance I could win. So
yeah.
He's a bad predictor. Hey, pleasure talking to you, sir. Thank you very much.
Very good. Thank you.
Take care. And watch Rand Paul. Go to Ron, Rand Paul. Watch Ron Paul, ronpaulchannel.com. That's the TV, online TV website that you could find him at. And, of course, he is also the founder of Campaign for Liberty.